Okay, so good afternoon. No, good morning, right? It's not afternoon yet. First of all, the homework is on the website. You saw that? I put it on a few days ago, and it is due next week. Okay, next week, this time at the beginning of the class, so I will collect it here at 9:45. Anything after that will be late. So bring it at 9:45 at the beginning of the class on this table right here, okay? So what we are going to do today is actually something you might have seen before, but I'm quickly going to go through the simple part, the 2D part, the two-dimensional part, and quickly jump into the three-dimensional one, which is really important for us. So the topic today is vector transformations, or I like to call it actually coordinate transformations. Vector transformations, it kind of implies that you're transforming the vector. That's really not true. That's not what we're doing here. We are transforming the representation of a vector in another coordinate system. So please take a note and say coordinate transformations. Okay, we like to call it as coordinate transformations or vector transformations. Basically what we are saying is we are going to rewrite a vector in a different coordinate system. So assuming that, you know, we have a vector here sitting in space, kind of looks like this. Let's say this is our vector. And let's call it a vector v, okay? And this is a vector that sits in space. It will not move. It's there. It will not, the magnitude, the direction will not change. It is a fixed or constant vector in space. So we are looking at that vector, and we would like to represent this in a coordinate system. Let's say this, we can represent this in any coordinate system, right? Let's say this is one of the coordinate systems we like to work with. And let's call this coordinate system x, 0, and y, 0. Basically, the axes are called x and y, just to represent it with, just to make it unique, I put some zeros there. So it's x and y, it's the coordinate system. So if this is a coordinate system, and if this was three-dimensional, then this would have been the z direction, right? Take the right-hand rule, again, go from x to y, and your thumb would be pointing in the z direction, so this would be z0. So it is a coordinate system that I just invented to represent this vector. And this, if this vector is in this plane, x0, y0, then I could actually simply write, just in two dimensions, the vector would be equal to some vx0 and some vy0. Zero, right? How do I come to this conclusion? Well, I just come to this conclusion doing this. I do this, and this would be one component of that vector, and this would have been another component of the vector. So you add them together vectorial in terms of vectors, and you get this. So this one would be vx0, this vector here, and this vector here would be vy0. And I'm writing this only in two dimensions. Just to make sure that we represent this vector in this coordinate system, I put a little zero here. Okay, looks a little funny now. Make it a zero here. So this just represents, according to our notation, the vector v written in this coordinate system with these two components. So you add this component plus this component, you get this one here. Okay, assuming everything is in 2D, so forget about this z0. Good. So here's the idea. I would like to rewrite this vector in another coordinate system, okay? In fact, the coordinate system is a very specific one. I'm going to write this coordinate system, this vector, in this coordinate system. So I'm just rotating this coordinate system here, and I will call this coordinate system x1 and y1. Okay, so it is a rotation around this axis, so this one is still pointing z1. So all I want to do is I want to rewrite this red vector, which I didn't move, it is still there, just in another coordinate system, okay? And it was a blue coordinate system. Now I want to rewrite this in the green coordinate system, x1, y1. So how do I do this? How do I do this? The way I do this is the following. Remember vx0 and vy0? We can decompose these two components into these components, into x1 and y1. So that is the idea, okay? So how am I going to decompose this? If you look at this, okay, in order to get vx0, you could do this. You could go this way, and then you could go this way, taking this one 90 degrees. So this one plus this one will give you this one, right? Good. I could do the same thing over here. I could go this way and go 90 degrees this way. Okay, so I went up x1, went y1, I'm sorry, go parallel to x1, and this is 90 degrees. This plus this will give you that blue vector. This plus that will give you vx0. Therefore, since vx0 and vy0, if you add them, you get the red one. It also means that if you add the green ones, you still get the red vector. You understand my point? I'm trying to represent the red vector v. And I know that v is represented by these two, or if you add these two components, this vy0 and vx0, if you add the two blue components, you get the red vector. Now what I'm saying is you can get this blue one, adding this yellow, this green vector and this green vector, and then you add this green vector and this green vector, and you get the blue one. So which means you add the green ones, you actually get the red one. So all I need to do is really find what these components here are. Now, assuming that this rotation here was by an angle of theta, which means then this is theta, right? I could actually represent, and this is theta, of course, so which means that using trigonometry, I could actually calculate these two numbers. So it's actually quite simple. So what goes all in the vx direction, in the x direction, I could call this vx1. So everything that goes in the x direction would be what? Everything would be, first of all, this one here, which is vx0, right? This one here, I'm looking at this component, times cosine theta, right? Since this is theta, so this would be cosine theta, times cosine theta. So everything in that direction, this one is in that direction, vx0 times cosine theta is here. And then what else is in this direction? That one there, right? So I'm adding that plus, right, vy0 times sine theta, right? So it's this one here, because now theta is here, and therefore it's the sine. So this plus this will give you everything on this component. Now I am adding the remaining, which is this and this one. So vy1 would be, this one here is vx0 times sine theta 0, okay, vx0 times sine theta 0, but notice that it is in the opposite direction. See, y1 is going up, but this component here, which is parallel to that, is going this way. So there must be a minus because it's going in the opposite direction, plus vy0, this one here, now I'm adding this one, times cosine theta, okay? So these are the two components that needs to go along y1 and x1 in order for us to represent the red vector. So what I did was really add this, all the green components, and say this is my new vector here. Okay? So my new vector is, I mean, it is still the same vector really. Let me write it by red, right? It's still my same vector. The vector v is now represented in a coordinate system that is represented with the subscript 1 and is equal to vx1 and vy1. Okay? So, very simple. So, what are these two components? They are these. How am I, did I write them there? I wrote them in this, in components of this other coordinate system. Right? I wrote this in the other coordinate system. So I could write this actually in matrix form. Let me write this in matrix form. Let me put it this way. I think this is good, right? This is good. So let me write this in matrix form, which basically means the vector vx1, vy1, which is a representation of the red vector in the new coordinate system x1, y1, is simply equal to a matrix that is made up of sines and cosines. And we can write this in terms of vx0 and vy0, right? The first coordinate system that I just represented. So what would that look like? Actually, I have it right here. I'm just writing this in the matrix form. So it would be cosine theta, and it would be sine theta, and then it would be minus sine theta, and it would be cosine theta. Okay? So, what did I just find? I just found some matrix that would represent this vector in another coordinate system, but it is still the same vector. Okay, it is still the same vector. So the only difference was that this was here, written in the coordinate system 0, x0, y0. This is one coordinate system. And this one was written in another coordinate system, x1, y1. And this matrix we call the transformation matrix. And it looks like it's transforming one vector to another vector, which is not true. It is the same vector. It is just rewriting one vector in one coordinate system and rewriting it in another coordinate system. That's all what it is. Okay? So this vector I could write. So what we probably need to make sure to write here is that same vector, never forget that, okay? These are not different vectors. Same vector written in different coordinate systems. Okay? Very important. It's written in different coordinate systems. And we call this a transformation matrix. Now assume that this was a three-dimensional thing. Now this is in 2D, right? This is in two dimensions. This is in two dimensions. But imagine that we want to do this in three dimensions, in 3D. Just writing the same thing in 3D. So it would be looking at this thing, but not only in X and Y, but also in the z direction. And you see in the z direction nothing has happened. Even if v, the vector, the red vector v, had a component in the z direction, if it had a component in the z direction, it would remain the same because in the z direction there was no change. We rotated it around the z direction. You understand that? So, for instance, in 3D, just trying to rewrite the whole thing, you know, if I had this, x, y, and z. And if this was my vector, and let's say this vector had one component in the y direction, one component in the x direction, and maybe, because we can't see it here, but it has a component in the z direction, it would look like this. Now rotate the whole thing around z. Let's call this again x0, y0, and z0, just to make sure it's the same coordinate system. And let's say if you rotate it around the z direction, I would still get the same thing. This would be x1, this would be y1, and this would be z1. But note that the component, the red component around the z direction will not change because they're pointing in the same direction. All the change would have been in this direction. So I could really say vz1 would be equal to vz0 at all times because the rotation would not change anything. So this is that rotation. Okay? So then the same matrix I just wrote in three dimensions would look like that. It would look like this. Vx1, Vy1, Vz1 would be equal to, again, let me put it this way, and here let's put Vx0, Vy0, and Vz0. Okay? It would still be the same here, cosine theta, sine theta, and then the z component would have a component of 0. Here again it would be minus sine theta, cosine theta, theta 0, no component here. And vz1 is equal to vz0 because there's no change over here, so it would be 0, 0, and 1. Okay? And this one is, as I said, we call this matrix the transformation matrix. Okay? We are transforming a vector that is written in one coordinate system, and we are writing it in another coordinate system. But never forget, it is the same vector. We are not changing the direction or the magnitude or anything about the vector. It is still the same vector. It's just written in another coordinate system. It doesn't matter from where you look at, who the observer is, and so on and so forth. Okay? So it is the same vector. We call it the transformation matrix. Sometimes this is called the directional cosine matrix. Okay? The directional cosine matrix. But we'll get to that in a minute. This is a rotation around one direction, okay? And this is really a rotation around z-axis, okay? This was really a rotation around the z-axis by an angle theta. By an angle theta. And this is what you get. Okay? It's a two-dimensional rotation in a three-dimensional coordinate system. And this is your transformation matrix if you just rotate around Z. Okay? Now, of course, you can do this around other axes as well. Now you can rotate around X1. Maybe you can rotate around Y1. And you can get a similar transformation matrix for each of these rotations. All you need to do is do what I did at the beginning around the Z-axis. Just do the same argument. Write the components of that v vector, and then rewrite that component in the new coordinate system. Make the trigonometric representation, and you get this. Right. So now you can do the same thing over here for other axes. And one of the axes I want to look at, before I do that, any questions on this thing? Do you fully understand what I'm doing? I mean, what I'm doing is actually really simple. It's just that you have to see first where it's coming from. If you just look at these matrices, if you just look at this matrix, you might actually think that you are transforming a vector to another vector, which is not true. You are just changing the coordinate system. You understand that part, right? Okay. So, as I said, we did this around the z direction, around the z axis, but of course we could do this around another axis. For example, we can rotate now a coordinate system around its x axis. By an angle phi. Rotate a coordinate system around the x-axis by an angle phi, which means if this was y and x, and this was z. Now we are going to rotate this whole thing around x. What would be a positive rotation, by the way? I mean, the rotation I did here, I didn't quite mention this, but this is a positive rotation. Do you understand that it's a positive rotation? Okay, sorry. This is the x direction, y direction, and z direction. So we are making a positive rotation. Positive rotation always means, you know, you take your right hand, put your thumb around z, and this is your positive rotation. So we made a positive rotation around z. So this theta here is actually a positive rotation around z, you see? Okay? So that's why everything is rotating this way. We could have rotated it in the other way, but then it would be a rotation of minus theta. Okay? I would not call it a positive theta rotation. A positive theta rotation around z is when I take my thumb and make that rotation with my right hand. Okay? So that's a positive rotation. So you might want to do the same thing for the x-axis. So which direction would you need to rotate this coordinate system if you wanted to do a positive rotation in the x-axis? You would just take your thumb and this would be a positive rotation. Okay? So let's make a positive rotation around the x-axis by an angle phi. Okay? So this would still be the x-axis. Let's call this x1. And the rotation here would be y1 and z1. And the rotation angle that we would be using here, I call it phi, would be phi. And this would be a positive rotation, you see. And it's now a rotation around x1. Again, to denote this, make this a x0, z0, and y0. So it is the red versus the green. And it's a rotation around phi. Now, you do the same argument that I did for the z-axis over here. You can just go ahead and do the same thing for x. What you would find is something like that. You would find vx1, vy1, and vz1 is equal to a transformation matrix vx0, vy0, v0, 0. Okay? So of course the vx now is the same. I mean, thinking that I have a vector here, of course, right? The same vector v. I have it here. Now I'm rewriting it in this new coordinate system, which I rotated around the x-axis. So since x is still the same, this will be 1, 0, 0, 0, 0. I can do this right now because I know the v-axis, vx1 is equal to vx0. And if you fill out the rest, you would see that this is cosine phi, this is sine phi, this is minus sine phi, and this is cosine phi. You see? I can't stress this enough. It's the same vector v. Same vector. It is just written in another coordinate system. And the coordinate system is a coordinate system that is rotated around the x-axis by an angle phi. Okay? So we rotated around z, we rotated around x. Now we have two transformation matrices. Let's get a transformation matrix if I would rotate this around the y-axis. Okay? So this would be the last one. Rotate the coordinate system around its x-axis okay y-axis, of course. Now we are going to rotate it around the y-axis by an angle. All right, so it would be quite simple, right, this time. So we had this, x0, and we had y0, and then we had z0. Now we are going to rotate around y0, a positive rotation. Again, take your right hand, make a rotation around y0. What you get is a rotation that would look like this. This would be x1, right, and this would be z1. And the rotation here would be by this angle, okay? And this would be still the same. Sorry, y1, this would be the same. So if you do this, again, you can try this, and you would get this vector. You can try this at home, try to obtain what I did for the z-axis, do it for these ones. You get this v1, vc1, and the transformation matrix would look like this. You had a cosine, you had a zero, you had a minus sign, and 0, 1, 0, because now Vx0 is the same, Vy1 is the same. You have a sine and a cosine. And on this side, you would have Vx0, Vy0, and Vz0. Okay? Again, same vector, and this is still called the transformation matrix. As I said, sometimes this is called the directional cosine matrix. But in this class, I like to call it the transformation matrix. And it is transforming the components of a vector in one coordinate system to another one. Okay? So, any questions so far? These are individual rotations of the coordinate system, one by one, around its coordinate systems, around its axes. First, I rotated around the z-axis over here. Right, that was the first thing. We rotated around the z-axis. Then I rotated around the x-axis, and then finally around the y-axis. So these are the transformation matrices. Now, here's what we like to do. Now listen carefully. This is what we want to do. We don't want to rotate a coordinate system only around one axis. This is not the goal. The goal is to take one coordinate system, look up here, take one coordinate system and rotate this coordinate system in all three dimensions. Not only around one axis, around all axes at one time. Okay? So we would like to represent a vector in one coordinate system. So let's make this our vector. This pen, let's make this one our vector. And this is my coordinate system. And the vector will not change. It will stay there. It is one vector. And this is my coordinate system. What I like to do is I would like to find the transformation matrix that I can use to write this vector in this coordinate system, but in an arbitrary different coordinate system which is rotated around all axes, not only one. Okay? What I did here was I rotated it only around one axis. That's not what I want here. This is not good enough. I want to be able to rotate it around all axes at once. So what is the transformation matrix that could take this, the representation of this vector in one coordinate system, and represent it in another arbitrary coordinate system, which is literally rotated around all axes at once? Okay, that's the goal. So this is how we approach this problem. And this is a mathematical fact now, which I will be writing to you. The mathematical fact. Actually, it's a geometric fact. Geometric fact is this. By rotating, the original coordinate system original meaning the first coordinate system, right? In our case, it is Ox0, Y0, and Z0. This is the one I was using. One by one, around each axis, we can find or represent actually that's a better word, we can represent the vector or a vector in any new coordinate system. Let's call this OX1, Y1, Z1. Okay? By rotating the original coordinate system one by one around each axis, we can find or represent a vector in any new coordinate system, which is this one. Okay? So this is a mathematical fact. You can, if you think about it, if you look at the geometry, you can convince yourself. I'm not going to give a mathematical or geometric proof here, but you can, if you think about it, it would make sense. Okay? If it doesn't, try to convince yourself by maybe doing some coordinate systems at home. I see every now and then in one of the exams, students having taping three pens together to make a coordinate system and rotating it during the exam, which is fine. But it's good that you can visualize it. Okay? So, here's what we are saying. If you had a vector, look up here, if you had a vector, and you had a coordinate system like this, and you want to represent this in any arbitrary new coordinate system, which is rotated around all axes, what you do is you rotate it first around one of the axes, then around another one, and then around another one, and you will reach the new coordinate system, and that new coordinate system will, and the vector will be represented by the new coordinate system. So let me try to explain this a little more clearly, okay? What I mean. It means this. Take a coordinate system and this time let's call it OXYZ. Okay? I'm dropping the zeros, the X0, Y0, Z0, just to simplify things. Take a coordinate system OXYZ. O meaning it's a right-handed coordinate system, okay? OXYZ. Right. Or represent this, represent a vector and let's call this one VX Y1 VZ in a new coordinate system, in a new coordinate system, in an arbitrary, let's call it in an arbitrary new coordinate system. Okay? So we are just going to represent it in another coordinate system. So this is how we do it. We take this vector VX, VY, VZ, okay? And we are going to rotate, first rotate the coordinate system. Again, we are not rotating the vector. The vector is the same. Rotate the coordinate system around its z-axis by an angle psi. Rotate the coordinate system around its z-axis by an angle psi and obtain the new vector representation Vx1, Vy1, and Vz1. Okay, this is what we did at the beginning of the class. We just rotated it around an angle called theta. Now I'm rotating it around an angle called psi. And note that Vz and Vz1 is the same, but they will not be the same because I rotated the coordinate system around its z-axis by an angle psi. Okay, first rotation. Secondly, take this new coordinate system and rotate x1, y1, z1, I mean rotate the coordinate system y1 around its y1 axis by an angle theta and obtain a new vector representation vx2, vy2, and vz2. Okay? Now note that we are rotating this whole thing around y1. We are not rotating this around this new y, because I obtained a new coordinate system and I know how to rotate each coordinate system by its by one of these axes. So I took this coordinate system, rotated it around z, obtained a new coordinate system. Now rotate the new coordinate system around its y, not the original one, okay? The original is gone. I already represented this vector in this new coordinate system. Now I am going to rotate this coordinate system around y1 and obtain a new one. Okay? So, finally, now I have a new coordinate system which is rotated around y1 of this coordinate system which was rotated around z. Now I'm going to rotate this coordinate system one more time, rotate this coordinate system, x2, y2, z2, around what's left, x, right, around x2 axis, and by an angle of phi, and we obtain a new coordinate system, vx3, vy3, and vz3. Okay? Third rotation. And this one is around x2, which is, x2 is the axis that was happening for this coordinate system. So, vector 1, vector 2, vector 3, no, 1, 2, 3, 4, right? We have four vectors. Are these different vectors? The answer is no. They are not different vectors. It's the same vector sitting in space. What did I do? I had one coordinate system, rotated the coordinate system around z, and obtained the same vector written in a new coordinate system. It's an intermediate coordinate system. I take this new coordinate system, rotate it around its y1 axis, obtain a new coordinate system. Still the same vector. Take this coordinate system, rotate around x2. What do I get? The same vector written in a third coordinate system. Now here's the trick. Doing these three rotations, three angle rotations of a coordinate system, for a coordinate system, you can go arbitrarily from any coordinate system to another third coordinate system in 3D. So what I'm trying to say is that the coordinate The coordinate system you have over here and the coordinate system over here can be two different coordinate systems arbitrarily represented in space. So one could be a coordinate system that is sitting, I don't know, in one direction, and the third one could be in a totally different direction. You can go from this to this by rotating the coordinates around their axes. Okay, one by one. You can rotate the coordinate system one by one around each axis. The good thing about this is that we already established the relation of two coordinate systems when you rotate it around one axis. We just did that. If you rotate it around z, we know the transformation matrix. If you rotate it around x, we know it. Rotate it around y, you know it. So all I need to do is use the transformation matrix to go from here to here, which I just found, right? And then use the transformation matrix over here, which I just found for this angle. and use the one for the one that I used for x, which I just found, use for this one, and multiply them actually, and get from here to here. Then I have one big matrix that will just transform one vector from one coordinate system to another coordinate system in 3D. Okay? Does that make sense? Okay, so let's give a break, and let's make it, again, not a long break. Let's make it exactly 5 minutes, okay? So come back at 10:41.